Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Barks podcast. It's Friday, the 26th of July, and I'm Louise Stapleton Frappell over here in sunny Spain, where it's 8 p.m. in the evening. And today we're going to be chatting to Adina Silberstein. Now, before I get Adina on, I'm just going to go through a quick advert from one of our corporate partners, Dog Biz. And for those of you that don't know Dog Biz, please pop along to their website where you can find out all about them. But if you want to make more and work less and perhaps want to help more dogs, the new Dog Biz University course, Money Matters, is designed to help you do just that. The course takes the stress out of setting prices and it helps you protect your income with policies that work better for dogs and for your business. You can join Dog Biz for their new on-demand course, Money Matters 101, Pricing, Policies and Packages. And to find out more about the course and other information, you can pop on over to dogbizsuccess.com. So that's dogbiz, Dogbiz, success.com. And you can use the promotion code MMPPG. So that's double MPPG. And you'll get a $25 discount off your registration. So, without further ado, I'm going to tell you a little bit about today's guest for those of you that don't know her. Adina Silberstein is an entrepreneur and she's a business coach. She specializes in processes, organization, company culture, and profitability. Adina is the founder, the president, and the CEO of award-winning Northwest Philadelphia-based professional pet sitting and dog walking company, Queenie's Pets. She's, as I said, an entrepreneur and a business coach. And she's committed to urban communities, to force-free practices, to empowering others, and ongoing professional and personal development. Queenie's Pets storefront operates as a boutique retail store, administrative office, and as a community center for pet owners. So lots of things going on there. Adina lives in Philadelphia with her fiance and their crew of rescues. Rotty Scotty, Melodrama, and Cats, Mouse, Ziggy, Brucey Marbles, and Tuxedo the Snacks. Wow, some cool names there. So without further ado, Adina, hi, welcome to this
Hi,
podcast.
thank you so much. And I'm really excited about this sponsor because it sounds like they're very on par with exactly what I empower people with. So I was excited to hear about what they've got on offer.
Absolutely, you definitely want to check them out. They're great people over there at Dog Biz, and yeah, it is. I think when I was looking at some of your information, there probably is going to be a little bit of crossover there, which makes it very interesting and very relevant for today's topic because we're going to be talking about your upcoming PPG webinar, aren't we?
Yes, absolutely. I'm really excited. It always gives me such joy to be able to help other professionals and especially like-minded professionals who are in the force-free space to grow their company and to see success and to make money and to make the lives of pets and their humans better. So I'm really excited to chat to anybody who signs on for the webinar and then hopefully even beyond and create conversations that can continue.
Oh, that's fantastic. And for those of you that don't know, that for some reason I've managed to sign up to the podcast and I've got no idea what we're talking about. The webinar that we're talking about is titled Say No More Often, Capitalizing on Your Unique Value. And it's taking place on Wednesday, July 31st, so not long now, at 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. Eastern Time. That's 6 p.m. GMT for those of you in the UK, and for all of you in Europe, it's 7 p.m. CET. And for people elsewhere in the United States or Australia and Canada, I apologize, but you're going to have to go on Google because I can't give any more time. So sorry about that, folks. But it's Wednesday, July 30th at 1 p.m. Eastern. You can go to the PPG website. I'll give you this information at the end as well, but you can go on over to the PPG website or the PPG BI, the British Isles website, and you can sign up for the live webinar. If you're listening to this podcast as a recorded podcast and it's after July 31st. Don't worry, you can still pop on over to the PPG website and you'll find the presentation, the webinar listed as a recorded presentation. So you will still find it. So don't think that you're going to miss out. Okay, so Adina, before I get into some questions, when I was sort of saying a little bit about you, I was talking about Queenie's Pets. Can you tell me a little bit more about Queenie's Pets and what exactly it is and what you do there?
Sure, absolutely. So Queenie's Pets makes the lives of pets and their humans better through exceptional and holistically minded pet care. So what we mean when we use the term holistic is viewing the dogs and the cats as whole beings who have emotional needs, social needs, physical needs, and really getting into the lives of not just the pets, but the human family as well, and taking care. So what we provide are daily dog walking services and pet sitting services when our clients are on vacation. And we also do other things such as educational forums at our storefront. We have a retail business. Starting next month, we're actually starting up in-home food delivery service. So we're really in the lives of the families that we serve, and then serving our community by offering workshops such as pet first aid certification and so forth. And as you mentioned in the intro, we have basically a community center for pet owners. So we have a cozy space. People can come in, they can sit and have a chat. They can go on our Wi-Fi and do some work on their laptop while having their friendly dog with them instead of going to a coffee shop where they might not be able to do that. So we really aim to foster a very community feel so that we're always open to doing a lot more than just providing the basic services. Oh, you know, this person comes and holds the end of a leash and my dog gets out to go potty, but we're far more than that. And so, you know, when I boil it down, we're dog walkers and pet sitters, but we are far more than that.
Absolutely. Sounds like you're far more than that. It sounds like a really cool place to come and hang out. Thanks. So if I'm ever in Philadelphia, I shall obviously do so. You'll be getting a phone
Me
call.
Too.
Hi, it's Louise.
Yeah.
Are people welcome actually to come? I don't know how relevant this is to what we're actually going to talk about, but would people be welcome to come if they've not got a pet of their own and come and make use of the facility and perhaps learn a bit more from you about getting a pet?
Yeah, absolutely.
If they were thinking about doing so.
Yeah, we have people come in all the time asking us, you know, about the different rescue organizations that are nearby or the shelter, how can they adopt a new family pet, or asking us, you know, unfortunately, sometimes about rehoming their own pet. And people come in asking all sorts of questions and for referrals to other resources. So we're happy to just be of service to our community in whatever format that should take.
Excellent. And on that same line, would you actually recommend that somebody came and spoke to you before they get the pet so that they could organize some of your services beforehand, before they've actually gone out and got their pet?
Honestly, that's some of our favorite people in the world, is the people who are really thinking in advance of what is their new pet going to need. And we frequently, with some frequency, get phone calls from people who say, you know, I'm adopting my dog, they're arriving next week, or you're coming in from the shelter next week, or in a month, or what have you. We'd really like to talk to you about what the services are that you offer. You know, we work a long work day, and can you tell me what you can do with, especially for puppy rearing. And so, of course, we have some rigorous things that we offer in terms of care for puppies to ensure that, again, it's not just we come and let them out of their crate and go potty, but we're doing a lot more, and our caregivers are trained. We do a monthly training in health, wellness, and behavior so that our caregivers are coming in and doing things to set that puppy up for a life of success and happiness and sociability. So yeah, we definitely, I love when people talk to us before they need us, and are really, because those are people who are really our ideal client, which is something I will be talking a lot about in my webinar, is how to identify and harness your ideal client. But when we see somebody who is planning ahead, who's really viewing their pet as a new member of their family or an existing member of their family, that's spot on.
I couldn't agree more. I'm a very happy lady having heard you say that. Yeah, I honestly couldn't agree more. They're also, I've got my own training business, and that sort of person is they're just wonderful people to work with, that they're really thinking about it beforehand. So yeah, excellent answer there. Okay, I've got some quite specific questions now related to your webinar, say no more often capitalizing on your unique value. My first question is, whether you're a solo entrepreneur or you manage a team, does being a boss mean that you have to do everything? Because we see this time and time again that the boss is literally doing everything, whether they've got a team or not, they're still trying to do everything. Is that what it means to be your own boss?
So I think that that's a great question because, there are tremendous differences between being a solopreneur and having a team to back you up. And when you're a solopreneur, you feel this need to, you have to answer every phone call. You have to, take on every client that calls, and you have to, you have to, you have to. And we really create that in our minds. And that's an unfortunate falsehood because we then get ourselves into this trap, which is very common in, especially in the pet care industry, a segment of pet professionalism, but where it becomes this 24/7 all-consuming business where, you're aiming to meet everybody's needs. And it doesn't have to be that way, and you can still be profitable by setting very expressed boundaries around when you operate, how you operate, and with whom you operate. And so while I have a nice sized team working with me, and I can lean on my executive team and I can lean on my caregivers to so-called pick up the slack or do all of the day-to-day work, which is fantastic, and they're an amazing team and make my life better. But it doesn't, even if it's just you can say, my phone turns off at 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock, whatever you decide works for you and your life, and you can have a life. And I really promise that to people. If you know who your ideal client is and you know how to set really strong boundaries, everybody can have that. So being a boss is actually about having the life that you want rather than, looking like, I don't know if you remember that old cartoon, I think it was from like the 80s, of Kathy who was always pulling her hair out. We don't have to look like that. We can be calm and happy. And I just came home from a 1 month vacation in Australia. So I can tell the Australian listeners, you are 11 between 11 and 13 and a half hours ahead of us. But for that 1 o'clock podcast, you have to wake up in the middle of the night to listen to it. But at any rate, I digress. So, you can really live a life that you want to and be a super successful entrepreneur and business owner.
So is that something that you actually recommend that people do, that they do have clear-cut boundaries?
Absolutely. It's one of the main points of the presentation that I'll be giving next week, and talking to people about how to do that and how to stand strong even when somebody's needling you and asking for a discount. And especially as you're beginning and getting your business up and running, you may be really afraid to turn someone away, but we have clients who come to us and tell us, I was trained with my dog on an e-collar, and we simply say to them, unfortunately, that value does not match ours. We are happy to give you the phone number of another provider of care. And we just send them on their way because their values don't meet ours. And, if they're open to a conversation about changing and listening, then we'll have that. But we have no hesitation because that leaves that space open for the client that we do want, the client who is force-free and believes in it, to come in, and maybe five more of them in place of that one.
And how would you deal with somebody? I'm going to give you a situation. Imagine you've got a, I'm sure this happened already. You've got a client, and they start pushing the boundaries a little bit. They want you to perhaps send somebody out earlier than usual, earlier than you'd normally start working, or later. Do you start letting those boundaries go? Do you give exceptions, or is the best thing to say, hey, look, I'm sorry, but when we signed up, you know that we work within this timetable, etc. What is the best thing for people to do when that happens to them, Adina?
I think it's really up to the individual. I think that there are people, again, we operate from fear when we break our boundaries. That's what we're doing. And, you know, the lock screen on my phone says, everything you want is on the other side of fear. So if we can put fear aside, we can approach what it is we want for the structure of our business and stick with that. And we have to have faith and trust in our skills, faith and trust in who we are and what we're creating as a business owner to have a business that is still successful and still turns people away. So to answer your question directly, when it certainly does happen, somebody maybe recognizes that they are a client of value to us and they'll say, well, can't you just this one time? Can't you do this or can't you do that? And it really depends upon what the request is. So, you know, if they want us to operate outside of our normal operating hours, we simply can't do that because I need to respect my employees. Not only do I have to respect laws of, you know, employment laws in my state and federal laws as well, but I also have to respect them as people and as my team. And so I operate, and again, one of my areas of expertise is in company culture and building the kind of culture to have that makes employees want to stay. And in our industry, turnover is tremendous and it can be the killer of your business. So you want to do and have policies that are staff friendly and not just profit friendly or not just client friendly. So it has to be a balance between all of that. So one of the things that I do teach people is you can fall in love with the line that says, as a one-time courtesy, I'm happy to do X, and then make it very clear that it's a one-time thing, that you are making an exception, but you still hold the power. You still get to be the person who decides, yes, I want to break that boundary right now in this moment for this person only. And then you get it in writing that you said for a one-time exception. And so you're giving that person a courtesy. You make them feel very special as you do that, but you're really clear that they shouldn't expect that you're going to do it again. So that's, you know, that's really how I approach that. And for most of the policies we have in place, a policy is a policy. So sticking to it makes you look more professional, even if the person isn't getting the answer that they want in that moment. They're actually, people surprisingly love rules, and because they know what they need to operate within and not, and where they can push the boundaries. Just like children, right? It's just like children. So surprisingly, kids who are raised with a lot of structure end up being very successful because they understand that the world operates within certain realms of rule and order.
Absolutely. And that was really nicely explained, Adina. Thank you. And I think, as well as, like you said, respecting the people that work for you, I think we need to respect ourselves. I don't know how many different presentations, in fact, I've seen about burnout in the pet care industry, because I think it does. You summed it up really well. It does take over people's lives.
Yes.
And they, oh, well, I need to help them. I need to help them. I need to help
right.
them. And
right.
The one person they don't actually help is themselves. And that then doesn't help anybody, because these people then end up going out of business because it's not sustainable. You can do it for a certain amount of time.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So really nicely explained. When you, said, and I know it's one of the learning objectives in your presentation, I'm maybe taking it slightly out of context, but you did just mention it again. You said operating from fear can negatively impact decision making. What exactly do you mean then by operating from fear? Do you mean that people are afraid to say no?
Absolutely.
Is that what you mean?
Yeah. Yes, I think so. We have a fear. Maybe we have a fear of not making enough money. And maybe we have a fear of garnering a negative review online. maybe we have a fear of not being seen as nice, or, you know, so, and I think especially our industries as pet professionals is heavily female dominated, and there really is a gendered aspect to this conversation. Women are not taught to properly set boundaries and to say no and to be firm. And so in an industry that ends up being heavily female dominated, there ends up being this crux of those of us who, you know, I'm not going to use the word, but are called a certain B word if we say no or if we set really clear boundaries. And so I really like to work with people on understanding that your boundaries takes you out of the place of fear and has you stand on 2 feet with strong legs as the person who is really in charge. You are the boss of your own business and you are running it. And it feels really good when you get to see yourself being successful instead of being afraid of not, you know, making enough money, or afraid of, again, that negative online review. And but when you're really, really clear about where you're coming from and why you're doing something, and you don't just have arbitrary policies or arbitrary charges, fees, that is, people understand and they actually will begin to respect it. And if they give you pushback and you remain really clear and steadfast, they will know where the boundary is and is not. So I think that once we are able to remove the fear of, you know, not making enough money or not being good enough or what have you, it opens up the doors so much to many more opportunities.
And can you give me an example of something that perhaps you haven't already mentioned, but some boundary or other that you yourself have imposed in your own business or in your own life that's actually affected your work-life balance in a positive way? And perhaps something that you changed because it was impacting your work-life balance initially in a negative way?
Great question. So I think the first one would be communication. So, you know, we live in this world where all of us are accessible all the time, and we're expected that our phone is always on, and it's, you know, whether it's a phone call or more likely nowadays a text message, everyone's expecting you to always respond. And so I have set some very clear boundaries. Initially, I set them with my clients by simply not respond back when I didn't have a leadership team and it was just me dealing with face-to-face with clients. I would just not answer any text messages or any phone calls that came in after 9 p.m. And even if someone was, let's say, calling in because they need a visit for their dog at 9 a.m. the next day, I have to turn off my heartstrings in worrying about, oh, is that dog going to be okay waiting until 10 a.m. when I can get a walker out there, or noon, or saying no. And I have to set that boundary for me, for myself, for my business structure, so that I'm not creating a new expectation each time. So I would then say, I'm going to respond to them in the morning. And then I may very well, and my company is actually, we're waiting to hear, we're finalists in the Greater Philadelphia Chamber of Commerce Customer Service Excellence Award. So we go above and beyond in excellence and in communication and in customer service to meet the needs of our clients, but still within boundaries. So I won't turn my phone back on until 9 a.m., but then I'm going to rush and I'm going to get back to that person and say, I really apologize. You called outside of work hours. Would love to be able to get over and walk Scooby this morning. I can be there by 9:45. And so we're still pleasing people, but we are setting it so that we can still get a good night's sleep. So that's one way. And then since I've had staff, I have set boundaries around when my staff is allowed to contact me. And when it's just an absolute that, you know, someone better be dead if they're calling me. So that's been really wonderful. A way that I had to really create a lot of change around communication, around a boundary was initially when I first started my business 13 years ago, I didn't have a ton of training in leadership and in being a boss. I opened my business not realizing I was going to be a boss within the first 3 months. And I was thrown into being a boss and I had to figure it out. And initially I wanted my staff to, I don't know if I would say necessarily be my friend, but I didn't want them to think I was mean, or I didn't want them to think I was harsh. And so I would bend rules and I would, prepay them on their payroll. And I would do all these things to accommodate them. And what ended up happening was a major HR problem where I was not respected as the leader of my own business. And I had to take stock and go take some management courses and really learn that, again, people love structure, even if you think they don't. And so being very clear with my staff on what my expectations are of them, what they can expect in return from me as a fair and honest leader of my business and company and as their boss. And so I saw a huge, huge turnaround, and my staff is amazing, and we get along great, and I adore them. And when something is not being done right, I'm very, very clear, straightforward, and upfront with them, and we get the problem resolved, or they need to leave my team. So I think that answers the second part of your question.
It does indeed. Thank you. And congratulations on being a finalist in the Chamber of Commerce Awards. That's fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you.
When are the results?
So we don't know. They said, quote unquote, this summer. So I have no idea if that means July, August. I have no idea. So hopefully soon.
Well, if you do find out and you managed to scoop that, then please let us know. But being a finalist, wow, that's fantastic. Really well done.
Thank you. We're very, very honored.
Okay, I've got a couple more quick questions before we come to an end, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
One of my questions is, again, I'm sticking with the boundaries thing, but can clear-cut boundaries actually therefore influence your profitability?
Ooh, I love this question, and that is because I definitely will talk about this in my presentation. 100%. And, sometimes you end up getting lucky. There's a low barrier for entry in terms of the capital that one needs to get into working with pets. Traditionally, I mean, there are, if you have a daycare, maybe you need to invest in the building and so forth. But a lot of us who are operating either in people's homes or from our own home initially, we don't have to put out a huge amount of capital. And so we see money coming in and we get really excited and there's this profitability and so forth. And later on, you need to begin to understand your numbers and understand why setting certain boundaries are going to dictate whether it's your top line or your bottom line. And your profitability is going to increase, and this is crazy, but your profitability will increase the more clear your boundaries are. Why? Because you are catering your business to the ideal client. And it's up to you to decide who is your ideal client. But for me, I tell people dinkwads, double income, no kids with a dog. Now, does that mean that I have no clients who don't, who have kids? Of course not. I will take clients who fit the bill in many other ways. And we have a rating system when people inquire with us to become a client. And I'm actually going to, anybody who attends my webinar can get the worksheets that I'll be talking through, including a way to rate incoming client inquiries to see, do they match your ideal client scenarios. So you can score them 1 to 3, 5 to 7, and so on, and decide how close are they to being ideal. And so when they're ideal, you know, I look at them and I see, okay, well, no kids and double income. That means they're both at work. They have a long day at work. They have this, they have that, they have all these different factors. And I'm parsing it together. And also, like, do I like them? Were they kind to my staff on their initial phone call? So that way I end up having a whole client base that I like, and it makes it so much easier to provide them with excellent customer service because our values match and they have a disposable income. So they're less likely to be price sensitive and aren't looking at their invoice for every single line. And so that means that we can simply provide the service as what their pets need, rather than just, oh, I'm just going to book this one walk and try and hope that my dog makes it to the end of the day and holds it. You know what I'm saying? So, so there's tremendous profitability in knowing and understanding who is your ideal client and how do you harness them as the bulk of your clients when you set your boundaries.
Brilliant. And that's something that you're going to expand on in your presentation, you said. So will you actually Yes. be able to help the attendees work out for themselves what their own ideal client is, what that client looks like?
During the presentation, probably, I don't know how much Q&A time you allocate. So I certainly can help in the sense of jogging their brains to think about it as I talk Yeah. through the models that I've set. And then, like I said, everybody who comes to the webinar, if they email me after the webinar, I will email them any of the worksheets that we work through in the webinar. And there are, I think there's 3 or 4 different worksheets. And so they can get those. And then also anybody who, you know, a shameless plug for my coaching business, but I love coaching people, and anybody who wants coaching after the session, that's absolutely something we can work towards. And we can work on how to set new boundaries if they're an existing business, and how to do that with finesse and elegance with their existing clients so as not to upset them.
Thank you, Adina. And I will say for you, I'm sure Sharon will actually tell you this as well, who will be hosting your webinar, but you will actually be able to give the handouts to Sharon beforehand so that they're available for people to grab straight away as soon as they listen to your live presentation. They should be able to grab your handouts, anything that you want them to have. So you can organize all of that. So everybody, what I'm going to say now, I'm going to encourage you, please, if you've got a pet business, sign up for this webinar. You can do so by going to the PPG website or the PPGBI, the British Isles website. It's listed on both. And again, I'll repeat, the presentation is called Say No More Often, Capitalizing on Your Unique Value. And it's Wednesday, July 31st. So you've still got plenty of time to register. Do so now. If you're listening to the podcast, I said this at the beginning, but if you're listening to the podcast and it's after that date, go on over to the website anyway, because it will be listed as a recorded presentation. So you will still be able to listen to the webinar. And my last question for you, Adina, which is such a shame because I'm really enjoying listening to everything that you've got to say. But my last question is, how can people learn more about Queenie's Pets? What's your website? What's your Twitter? What's Facebook, etc.? Sure. If you could give us some contact details, that would be great.
Absolutely. So we are queeniespets.com. That's QUEENIESPETS. And that's for all the dog walking and pet sitting services. That is also, there is a page on there dedicated to my coaching services as well. We are at Queenie's Pets across all social media handles. And for my coaching, I am at Adina Joy Coaching. So that's Adina Joy Coaching on Instagram. So if anyone, you know, they can email me as well. I'll be giving out all those, that contact detail in the webinar.
Thank you, Adina. That's absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much for taking time out of your day to join us today. And very much looking forward to your upcoming presentation. So I'm going to pre-thank you for that because I know it's going to be great. So
great.
Thank you and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you. And for everybody still listening in, we've got another Barks podcast coming up on the 6th of August, and we'll be talking to a cat consultant. Daniel Quagliozzi is going to be with us, and he's the owner-operator of Go Cat Go in San Francisco. And the topic is going to be consent to touching, how overstimulation and petting aggression can actually be avoided through awareness of human intention and the understanding of feline body language and thresholds. So looking forward to that. So again, thank you, Adina. Thank you, everybody, for listening in, whether you're listening in live or to the recording. We appreciate it. And I hope you all have a great rest of the day.
Thank you.